If they have them exactly the same, they're still confirming next year.
Oh, she has it, but okay.
It might be easier if it is.
There we go.
Get that for sure.
Yeah, there's people pretty much in
there. I feel like just seeing that talking with people in the, there's a couple people out there that are coming in, and I told Justin to watch it and start seeing the
general people
as soon as possible.
So here we go. Are you all ready to start?
How many people
are? I guess not. I'll wait for everybody to sit down. And one thing, our illustrious Dr. Haynes suggested is that we all make sure that we remain masked and spaced. We've done really well avoiding any of the flu for the most part, the virus, but we want to continue to maintain that. We're coming into the tough time of year for that sort of thing, so let's do our best to stay after it. So as your president, I hereby declare this 2021 annual general meeting of the Semiahmoo Resort Association officially open. I'd like to start by introducing the most important people in the room, and that is our staff that made this happen. So Lori Thorne, Carol Ballard, where are you, Carol? She may be outside. Okay, and I know Justine Brooks is outside as well. And our illustrious Debbie Smith, executive director for 34 years. I'm gonna start with, it's not advancing.
Stephen.
Good way to start. There we go. So click on this. There we go. Okay, now that we've got that fixed. So I want to introduce our board of directors. I'm Doug Woods, as I mentioned earlier. Jeff Ferry on my left here. Jeff, you want to raise your hand and say hello? Jeff is chair of our governance committee. Steve Geisels, our corporate secretary. Joe Sothi, who is on special assignment down in Palm Springs, is on via Zoom, and I think we'll be able to see him, his face a little bit later. Joe is chairman of our finance committee. Dr. Steve Haynes is chair of our architectural standards committee. John Palin, my far right here, is chairman of our maintenance committee and has also been instrumental in our IT efforts. Patricia Oliveros. Patricia is chairman of the communications committee. She's our sergeant at arms, and she'll be retiring after this meeting, or I guess at the end of the year. Let's see, Bill McNally, far left here. Bill is chairman of the environmental committee. Bill also will be retiring at the end of his term this term. And Jane Moore, who is chairman of our safety and security committee, is dipping her toes in some exotic resort someplace on the Mediterranean and will not be joining us today, unfortunately. The Semiahmoo Resort Golf and Spa position on the board is currently vacant due to Nicole's departure from the resort. To Debbie here.
Voted received staff, excuse me, those that voted, we received 48% quorum. On the proof of notice, the notice of the annual meeting addressed to all members at the address on record at the Association Administration Office was mailed by the printer on September 30th, 2021. And this is the proof of mailing. And we also email to those that have given consent to provide our information via email. I wanted to let the audience know the meeting's being recorded today for the purpose of the minutes. And we'll start with a number of short presentations reporting to you on 2021 activities and looking forward to 2022. After that, we will open the floor for questions. So if you please hold your questions until that time. Thank you.
Was it not one of those mornings that makes you just feel like you really appreciate living here when you drove down on the spit this morning? The mountains were out, there was fresh snow on the tops of the mountains, the herons were in the water, there was a sailboat on the bay. I go, you know, we live in probably one of the most spectacular places in the world amongst some of the friendliest people in the world. So welcome. I want to thank you all for voting, for your participation this morning, and for your patience through this past year. It's been a challenging year, but fortunately, we've had a lot of help from many of you who have volunteered on committees, provided assistance, encouragement, advice, some solicited, some unsolicited. But we thank you, and I can sincerely say that it's all been very much appreciated. I believe it's the opinion of our board that our community, as a result of a lot of hard work and the effort of many, has come back together stronger than ever. I'm not going to get real granular this morning about all the many things that the board has kind of taken on and done. But what I want to do is just provide some highlights of the things that we've accomplished to pretty much create context as our committee members will then present the work that their committees have done this year. We started the year in strategic planning sessions. We updated our vision and mission statement, which were on some of the opening slides you may have seen, but are also on our website. We updated our 1, 3, and 5 year goals, which will again be updated at the beginning of next year as we onboard our new directors and update our strategic plan. At the beginning of this year, we committed to improve communication and take steps to rebuild trust. To do that, we conducted 5 town hall meetings. We conducted 5 focus group meetings, 2 of which were ASC and maintenance related, 3 of which were budget related. We softened the rules and expanded resident interaction in board and town hall meetings. We identified and reinforced community communication channels and worked with the finance committee to endorse 3 out of 4 resident-sponsored CCNR amendments on which you all voted this election cycle. The board made it a point this year to really focus on our basics. We're not a real complicated organization. Mainly what we need to do is focus on maintenance, communication, and effective planning. And that's what this board mission has really been most of this year. Through the year, we kept our focus on continuing to evolve the separation of governance from management. We refined and focused several committee charters, including restating and clarifying the deliverables in order to support our strategic plan. We worked to build trust and better communications. We implemented a more inclusive budgeting process, which I think is one of the most important things that we did this year. To that end, 2 of our town halls and 3 of our focus group meetings were dedicated exclusively to identifying budget spending and priorities. We worked with our maintenance team to focus on maintenance strategy and planning. Bruce Bishop, our director of maintenance, implemented important maintenance safety policy and added safety equipment and supplies to help protect our employees and comply with state law. Joe and Debbie worked diligently together to consolidate our banking relationships down to a single bank specializing in homeowner association needs, the kind of needs that are unique to what we do. And they also implemented systems in the office to create increased efficiency. We're in the latter stages now of upgrading our website, which will add a GPS-based digital mapping component for better management, fast access to critical information on plats in CCNRs, in the various maintenance requirements of the Neighborhood Homeowners Association, and even down to homeownership, which will be available and access for all of us. And that'll be, access to that data will be on a password basis. You'll see that an example of that website a little later on in our communications committee presentation. We've upgraded our IT systems in the SRA building for the management team, and they can now actually print from their computers. They can share files. And a critical benefit of all of that upgrade is cloud-based archival system for record preservation and office efficiency. The other thing that we anticipate doing here in the next month or two is the directors will be given SRA, HOA addresses, email addresses, so that we can preserve that communication on our servers. Finally, and probably one of the most important accomplishments that we were able to achieve this year is that we balanced a very out of balance budget. And I think that was something that we really appreciate everybody on the board having been diligent in making sure we get that handled. So those are the highlights of the accomplishments over the past year of your board. As president, I really want to do two things. I want to thank the families, the spouses, and the significant others of everybody, our staff, our committee members, and our board members for the support we've received from you all. It's, you know, you can't just come up and do this. Somebody has to help with the dishes, right? So, and the cooking and everything else. So, I'd also like to thank the board members, the SRA staff, and all of our committee members for their relentless commitment to teamwork and to bring the community together and to continue to build on a very solid foundation and a heritage that will ensure a bright, successful future. So with that, I'm going to yield the podium to our remote Joe Southey. Perhaps while we wait for Joe, Steve could stand up and sing a song for us.
Yeah, that's right. You've not heard me sing. I think he was referring to you.
Teach us.
Karen.
Thank you, Lori. I was muted the whole time. Sorry, I was trying to get on. So welcome all of you. I can't see any of you. All I can see is the presentation in front of me, but thank you all for attending the AGM. This is my first AGM and one that I was looking forward to. I joined the board, or I put my name forward to be a member of the board back in February, and I was nominated to be on the board and voted to be on the board at the March meeting with another member, and then a couple of others of us joined since then. So the one thing that I wanted to say is last year during the AGM, I know it wasn't a fun AGM for many of the residents, and I know it probably wasn't a fun meeting for the board. There were some issues that were deemed to be a little bit contentious, and what my goal was with the existing members of the board was to see if we could have an AGM and presentations and communications to residents so that the residents would be in sync with what our joint goal for the community was. Please keep in mind, I'm stating the obvious, that each and every one of us is a resident of this community. And we all generally have the same goal in mind, which is to spend the right amount of money on the right things within the community to preserve the beauty and continue to beautify our community as it continues to mature. So with that, I want to move on to the next slide, please, Debbie. So this is just a little bit about how the SRA and any HOA works. The accounting structure of any HOA community consists of an operating fund and a restricted reserve fund. The operating fund is basically where money is collected from the residents and spent on every year operating activities. The restricted reserve fund is money that is collected and kept for infrastructure types of items, which are generally items that of a capital nature that will last a long time. Things like gates and signs and roads and paths and all those types of things generally fall under the reserve fund, when we need to do significant expenditures on any of those types of things. Other things are also bioswales that are in the management of the SRA, where the water needs to move from the top of hills down to the bottom of hills without creating little floods or pools of water, et cetera. All those types of things are done separately. I know most of you know this, but some of you don't, because I've had some questions about that in the past. On the balance sheet that is presented, the amount of money basically that we hold in cash at any point in time represents the equity that the association holds. So when you think of a house, you have your house, and if you have a mortgage, you have the equity. The same type of thing exists within the SRA. Basically, the cash balance right about now is about a plus or minus $1 million. And so we're in pretty good shape. But when you think of the fact that we've got a community that's in excess of 30 years old in some parts, and we've got roads that are that old in many parts, having $1 million in the bank is not necessarily a significant amount of money if something were to happen to some of the infrastructure components of our community, which we are seeing in not on the roads, but on some of the gates and the on a future slot. One thing that we've done significance that was on by the board is we must have had three financial institutions and around 10 bank accounts to manage the monetary needs of the association. The main reason that was done was so that we had FDIC insurance from each institution, so that if something happened to any of those institutions, we would be covered by the FDIC program. What the board over the, in the last part of last year and the early part of this year found was that there was, or there were a couple of banks who focused on HOAs where they had FDIC insurance in one or two specific accounts where they invested the funds from the, that HOA, in our case, it'd be ours, in multiple bank deposits. So effectively by using one bank, we have, if we have the money in that account or accounts, we are actually investing in the deposits from multiple banks. So by with having one bank, we are fully FDIC insured, and we don't have to worry about moving money back and forth between different banks and different accounts, which, as you can maybe imagine, can be an administrative issue. So by the end of the year, we believe that, or we are targeting to have all of the money in that one bank, which was chosen last year to be CIT Bank. It's an online bank, but there is no problem with depositing checks or making withdrawals or depositing cash. We can, there are many ways that are very easy to accomplish what we need. In addition, by using a bank that doesn't have a presence in the community or on concrete that you can walk into, we are actually earning more interest on our deposits. On one of the accounts, we're earning, and I know it's not very much, but we're earning 0.25%. On the other banks that we were using, we were earning 0.01%. So that difference is 25 times greater. Now, when you're dealing with teeny tiny numbers, it doesn't really matter, but it's significant because right now, instead of earning less than $10 a month in interest, we're at least earning close to $200 a month in interest. So that's a little bit about the accounting structure and what we've done with our banking. What I've chosen to do for this presentation is not include a presentation with lots of numbers. Numbers, when you're doing a presentation, are not necessarily easy for people to understand, certainly not view very well on a screen. And when it flips by really quickly, you can't necessarily figure out what I was just talking about. I want to focus on the points and the important items in our community. The numbers are in the AGM package that were sent out a month ago approximately, and you might have them with you in the audience, or they are available on the SRA website. And I know many of you might have phones or iPads or something like that. So if you were feeling like it, you could go onto the SRA website and have a look at them as I'm talking or as this presentation is occurring. So next slide, please, Debbie. So the operating fund, I'm gonna do a highlight of 2021, and then I'm gonna move on to highlights or what we're thinking of doing in 2022. So when this presentation was prepared in the middle of September, we were about two thirds of the way through the year. At that time, 2021 for the operating fund has a current projection of about $11,000 under the revenues coming in. So it's a small deficit of $11,000. Now that we're having the AGM, it's about a month and a half later. Of course, items happen throughout the whole period of time. We're now closer to a pure balanced budget on the operating fund. My last kick at the can was that we were going to be about $1,000 or $2,000 in a surplus position for the operating. So just some small highlights on the revenue side. SRA dues have been collected from all the residents except for two as of mid-October. And those two are mitigating circumstances, and we've been working to collect them. I am very happy that our residents are actively paying their dues, because we need the residents to actively pay their dues and not have us go collecting so that we can run the operations of our association effectively. Another highlight, if you remember in the last AGM, they voted to have, or the board brought forward and the community was okay with having a transfer fee included. There was a larger transfer fee that was voted down, but we kept an administration fee for doing the paperwork within the community. This was a large sale year in the community. I believe we approximately forecasting close to 15% of all the properties in Semiahmoo turning over. In a couple of slides, Debbie will tell you about individual communities and what has happened in the last year since the last AGM, but approximately 120 properties being forecast in this calendar year is quite a bit higher than in past years. And it's actually helped us because we get $250 per transfer. So that's helped us get about $30,000 into the revenue bucket. And next year, it's forecasting to be a little bit less because we don't imagine the amount of properties that transfer this year is going to be able to continue or is going to continue next year. We, in 2021, we planned for 10 new home construction fees to be collected. And as it's turning out, it looks like it's going to be about 15 by the end of the year. And the last thing on the revenue side of significance was in 2020, the federal government, as it gave to many businesses, provided the SRA with a $55,000 federal loan that was potentially forgivable. Well, in May, it was forgiven to the association. So as a result, they gave us the cash in 2020 to fund some of the employees who were not able to work during the first few months of COVID. So it was forgiven, which meant that the income actually became ours rather than a loan in 2021. Highlights for the expenditures. Salaries are lower than planned due to a few employees leaving during the year. And at this moment in time, they haven't been replaced. We have part-timers who are doing the work mainly in the maintenance side of the business. And they've been doing a great job taking care of the things that they can take care of. Repairs and maintenance were a little bit higher, mainly due to the contracted landscaping at the gates that happened, I believe, in June and July. And they certainly looked a lot better once we had that contract landscaping done. And professional fees were lower, mainly due to the treasurer, which is me, taking on the internal accounting role, where that accounting role was forecast to be costing quite a bit of money during this year. But this was offset by some higher legal fees due to some unforeseen issues and a land use consultant that wasn't in the budget, even though he was being contracted at the time, where we're going to get a full mapping of our community. Next slide, please, Debbie. The reserve fund. So last year, when the reserve fund that went to the AGM had a projected deficit greater than $160,000. And I was on the resident side of the room, and I didn't understand how we could be collecting $80,000 in revenue for the reserve fund and then forecasting to spend $162,000. We don't have a big enough fund to spend that amount of money. So the one thing that we focused on is we will only spend money, especially from reserves, but also operating, on things that were needed and not things that were maybe wanted or desired. As a result, and this is also in the AGM package, the current forecast for the reserve fund in 2021 is actually a small surplus. So we went from spending in excess of $240,000 that were in the plan for 2021 to now it looks like we're going to spend somewhere around $70,000, $73,000, whatever it might end up being. There are still a couple of items on there that have not been spent in 2020. And it is possible that we will, if we don't need to spend, number one, if we don't need to spend it, we won't spend it. If we do need to spend it, and we can't spend it because the weather is getting a little bit worse and it's more difficult to do some of these reserve infrastructure types of spending or maintenance issues, we will roll it into 2022. So it is very possible that we will have a bigger surplus in 2021 on the reserve fund, but the 2022 spending will go up because we need to take care of the projects that we need to take care of. It's just a timing issue. So the main ones that were deferred is in the plan for 2021 was resurfacing one of the SRA roads, but nobody on the current board and including maintenance thought that that was necessary. So we saved close to $100,000. The Drayton Hillside bioswale does need maintenance, but it's going to be done a significant amount in 2022 rather than in 2021. And the SRA building improvements, there was a forecast for $65,000 in the 2021 reserve budget. None of those are important in order for workers to do their job. So they're just being deferred until we need to finish the top floors on the maintenance side and the admin side, as well as the stairs and some other things. We will need to spend that amount of money. We just didn't need to spend it right now. Next slide, please, Debbie. So one of the resolutions that was put forward to you was on debt. Now that resolution was basically what the finance committee, and I'm on the finance committee, we wanted the residents to be involved in any more assumption of debt that the association would take on. So what I wanted to do is summarize where we are with our current debt that we have, or that was incurred in 2021 or in earlier periods. So the SRA Center loan that was obtained, and it's through a financial institution called North Coast Credit Union. It was opened in 2020. It's a 15-year term mortgage. The interest rate is 5%, and the current balance outstanding is $695,000. We also have a line of credit through the same financial institution that was set up by the previous board last year, and it has no money drawn and has not had any money drawn on it. It was available in case of emergencies. I already talked about the PPP loan that we received last year. In May of this year, it was forgiven, so that's no longer a loan. There was a Kubota tractor note payable for the tractor that we have that we bought in 2018. It was in the amount of $73,000, as you can see on the slide. It was a 60-month duration with no interest rate. So I had a couple of people ask me, I know you're thinking of paying off the loan. Why are you thinking of doing that when it's 0%? Here's the reason. Nothing is free. If you were to go buy a car these days and you have a low interest rate, you can almost always receive, or you can get a couple thousand dollars off the cost of the car. This is the exact same thing that happened with the Kubota tractor. I asked Debbie and she was able to obtain right away. What if we were to pay it off right now? This is a couple of months ago. So there was always a declining balance about how much you would be able to pay off. So instead of paying off the approximately $25,000 that was able to on the loan, if we were to make payments between now and July of 23, I actually made a decision to pay off the balance, the payoff now balance, which was approximately $24,000. So we saved 3.2% by paying it off now. I'm hoping that the people who asked the question and who actually obtained the loan understand that an interest rate of zero is actually rarely zero. It's you can pay, if you pay it off now, you get a discount. So we don't owe any more money on that Kubota tractor. In addition, we don't have the administration of having to deal with, you know, another fleet. 22. So all the budgets, if possible, at the beginning of the year and not have to try and figure it out through the end of the year. So just a summary, last year, if you were to look at what was eventually agreed to be the operating budget that was adjusted after the AGM, as well as the reserve fund, and you did some calculations, we were in excess of $270,000 of a deficit in total between both funds. If the goal in the 2021 budget was to balance the budget where we have the same amount of revenues coming in as we do have spending coming out, you would have had, and when I say you, I mean me as well, a 30% in 31% increase in your dues. The board last year decided that they didn't want to have a board increase, didn't want to have a dues increase. And what that would have meant is if we kept to the spending plans on the reserve and operating side, we would have had a deficit in our cash balances at the end of the year of about $270,000. As I mentioned earlier, we don't have a ton of money. We have some money. We don't have a ton of money. But my goal is to not start depleting the amount of money that we have. So my goal is to have a balanced budget that we're bringing out at the beginning of each year for the AGM. As a result of that, because we don't, the main reason we don't have the PPP income coming into our fund this time, as that was a one-time revenue, we are going to have less revenue coming into the association, even if we're proposing to bring the revenue, the dues up by almost 3%, 2.8%. So we are going to be working with actually less money, even though we are bringing the amount of dues up a little bit. It's a nominal amount. I think inflation is running a little bit higher than that these days, unfortunately, but it's a nominal amount. But once again, it's important that all of you understand, we are going to do the best that we can to spend money on the operating fund and reserve fund only on needs of our community and not on desires or wants. And certainly not on desires or wants that the board thinks is best rather than going to the residents and getting their approval for those types of things. A small little bit on the revenues. We are forecasting the ASC this year to have 12 new home construction fees. Just to let you know, if we don't bring, there's a couple of communities that we haven't brought on yet, like for instance, Carnoustie, that is not being forecast to come online in 2022, nor are we thinking that any other community new properties are going to come on board. So we're thinking of the approximately 100 lots that are in the main Semiahmoo community. About 12 of them will be applied for new construction home fees. As I mentioned earlier, there are forecast to be 15 and 21. And what the goal is of those fees is to try and pay for the new the construction compliance consultant who goes around and sees what is necessary in the community or in the building to make sure that each building meets the needs and architectural standards of the community, in addition to covering off a portion of the ASC staff person's time. In the beginning of 2021, this year, we realized that the amount of money we were paying for the CCC at that time, the construction compliance consultant at that time, was less than market rate. That person, who happens to be a resident, decided that he wanted to spend more time doing things that he wanted to do, call it retire. And so we needed to hire a new person who just came on board a week or two ago. And the staff person who was in place late last year when the 2021 budget was done was also being paid under market for what we needed her to do, which is why we needed to get a new person in place. So it's looking like we're going to need to increase the $3,000 fee per new house to more like $4,500 to cover the increased market costs of those staff people. On the expenditures side, as was mentioned earlier, we are going to focus on maintenance. If you look at the budget that was presented, the maintenance is going up by quite a bit of money. And that is because the administration costs are coming down. We're going to defocus on administrative types of ventures, and we're going to focus on maintenance types of ventures. We need to do better for the community to make it look better for the community. So the main reason for costs going, you'll see that costs overall are actually decreasing in 2022 by about $45,000. The main emphasis is on maintenance, on administration decreasing. And the main reason is the management services that were in place for the beginning of the year are not going to be in place at all for 2022. So one more slide, please, Debbie. Lastly, the 2022 reserve fund highlights. So what we decided to do is go around our community a few months ago and see what are the things that we need to spend money on that are considered to be infrastructure. There was a complete review of all the roads, and other than a few maintenance issues that might need to be fixed or will need to be fixed, which are more maintenance oriented rather than infrastructure oriented, we don't think that the biggest expenditure that will happen eventually is pavement. Roads and paths. So we're not going to need to spend very much according to our assessment of those. What we will focus on in 2022 are a couple of big items. Number one, in terms of amount, is there are a number of entry signs in the community that are falling over. They're leaning forward, and it's mainly because they've been in place for 20, 30 years, and they're rotting. They're all made of wood and they're rotting. Their actual useful lives were probably not meant to be 20 or 30 years, and they're showing their age. So if many of you have probably been down to the SRA building and see the sign down there, we're going through a debate about what kind of sign, what kind of materials are going to be best to use. But we're estimating that in 2022, we might replace up to 10 signs and the posts associated with the signs this year. We've got some very preliminary cost estimates, but we know in order to maintain the look and feel of our community, something needs to be done to those. The second biggest item in terms of amount is the Drayton Hillside 2 bioswale. It is going to be worked on when the weather gets better in the spring, towards the summer. There needs to be, I don't believe that there has been significant work done for quite a few years. It's deemed now that we need to do some significant work in order to get it operating so that the water will run where it's supposed to run and not affect any of the communities or areas along the way. And the last big thing, and some of you might experience it, I've experienced it a few times, is we have had problems with our gate operators. So we have different kinds of gates in our different communities. Some open in and some slide across. The ones that generally slide across have been here for longer than the ones that open inwards. We need to replace some of them because we are spending a lot of time and effort having to put maintenance on it for a couple hundred dollars every time we touch them. You know, $100 here, a couple hundred dollars there. A couple days ago when I was leaving the community, I went to go out of the community where I live, and the gate wouldn't work to go out. I was actually car number 4 in line, and we were just waiting to get out. So we went through the end door. Well, that's not acceptable. And that's been happening a bunch over the last number of years. It's no fault of anybody. It's not fault of maintenance people, not fault of the board. It's just wear and tear over older gates and operating systems to the point that now we need to start replacing the operating system. I'm not talking about the actual gates that slide, unless some of them or one of them is in really bad shape. I'm talking about the boxes and chains that actually open the gates. There's going to be, we've come up with a plan. John Palin may touch on that in a little bit, but we've come up with a plan to replace all the ones that need replacing over the next few years. And the ones that need the most urgent attention will be replaced first. But we're not gonna spend tons of money on this kind of stuff. We're gonna do what we need to do. And that basically concludes my chatter on the reserve fund and 2022. And the last thing I have is the next slide, please, Debbie. The homeowner dues, which are in the package as well that you received, so you're probably aware of them, we're increasing the total assessment by $292 per assessable unit. That is a $22 unit increase over the $270 that was in place in 2021. So for the year, which will again be billed in two separate installments, in February, it will be due, and in August, it'll be $1,168 as opposed to the $1,080 for a home with its own lot. That'll be the most for anybody except for the resort, and it'll be less than that for condos or homes that are considered condos. The operating fund is, as I mentioned earlier, a 2.8% increase. And the restricted reserve fund to start building the balances up, because we don't want to be drawing down on our reserve fund when it's going to be needed sometime soon. It's 60% is a lot of money, but $40 an assessable unit is not a ton. So that is the one that is going to be going up the most, but it's going to be put towards the things I just chatted about, which is infrastructure items. I believe I am finished. Thank you very much for listening. Now I'll move to, me again, because now I got to talk about the auditor's letter. So if you could flip a couple of slides, please, Debbie. So in the package was the abbreviated audit report. An audit report is typically a lot of pages. So in essence, what you see on the slide that's being shown, and then the next slide, which is a whole bunch of numbers, is basically the report, as well as the balance sheet. And in essence, I used to be an auditor. What the auditor has done is given a clean bill of health and a clean sheet to the SRA for the 2020 financials that were presented to them. In essence, what that means is the way we accounted for all the goods is in accordance with generally accepted accounting principles, as you know, in the United States. A clean bill of health is a good thing, as many of you know, because many of you were business people or are business people. Getting a clean audit is the desire, and we got one. And I believe that concludes my presentation as treasurer, and I'd like to turn it back to Debbie, who will give some information on our community. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Joe. All right. It's great to see everyone here in person today, and we appreciate those that are attending remotely via Zoom. We like to begin by welcoming the new members to the SRA. Is there anyone here in attendance today that is a new member? If so, would you raise your hand? Welcome. Very, very nice to have you here. As you can see, we've had 146 closed transactions from last year at this time. The actual number for 2021 is approximately 110. And as Joe mentioned, we're looking at probably about 120. And obviously the larger transactions have taken place in the, just a second here. Oops, sorry. Back here. In the St. Andrews Green neighborhood at Pacific Point and at Sea Smoke. At this time, or as of October 26, we have 7 pending sales, and you can see by comparison, last year we were at 24, so that's lower. And then in 2019, there were 8, and in 2018, there were 14. And I'm delighted to once again introduce the administration team. Justine Brooks is now in the room. Justine and Carol is in the back corner there. Hopefully you had an opportunity to meet them at the registration table, and Lori Thorne, who's been with us since 2015. So we're delighted to have all of the staff members in place. They're doing a fantastic job. Next, we have the maintenance team, and from left to right is Mike Larson, and then Leroy Dougal and Bruce Bishop. And then, as mentioned, we've welcomed construction compliance consultant John Gordon, and he just joined us earlier this month. We always stress the importance of contacting us for any questions you may have, any concerns, and so on. And so you can always find our contact information at on the website. And we continue to talk about communication, which is so important. If you haven't already done so, please contact Lori and provide her with your email address. As mentioned on the slide, the benefits are SRA this week, SEMI-E News, which we thank Sylvia Hayden for producing that as a member of the Communications Committee. And it also provides you with any community alerts. And so please give us your email address and consent, which will also help us with cost savings for the annual meeting and other mailings that have to take place. And as always, we encourage you to attend board meetings and community, committee meetings. And all those dates are on the website for you to find out when those take place. And just a reminder that we do have a YouTube channel as well where you can view board meetings. I typically like to take an opportunity to acknowledge all the past presidents of the SRA. Everyone gives so much of their time as volunteers, and I have to say that typically the board president steps up with more time committed to the community. So this is a list going back basically from the beginning of time, once the declarant had turned over the presidency to the board of directors. And I see we have Alec here today, and I'm not sure if we have any other past presidents here, but again, we appreciate that. And in closing, I'd just like to thank all of the board members and all of the community volunteers. They do so much on behalf of your community, and I think they deserve a round of applause. So if you join me. So with that, that will complete my presentation. And next, as we talk about community volunteers, if you are interested, you're welcome to contact Lori at the email address that is shown. Also visit the website and take a look at the charters to get a better understanding of where your talents might be well utilized within the community. So again, we just really encourage anyone that's interested in stepping up to help out to do so. So with that, I'm going to now, we'll begin the committee reports. And we'll begin with Steve Haynes as ASC chair.
Thank you, Debbie. I'll step out of line for just a moment. I think that we should express our thanks to Debbie for her long, valuable service to the community. We've been asked to be very brief in our comments on the committee reports, and so I will be. The members of the committee are listed here, and we have what I think is a very good and committee with appropriate experience. Bill Chapeau is a retired architect. Guy Kelly and I are homeowners, but we have a lot of experience owning homes. Larry Kyle is a retired civil engineer. Todd Lipinski runs a large construction firm that doesn't do home building in the neighborhood. And Karen Zaslow has extensive experience in gardening and landscaping. So it's the expertise on the committee for doing this job is superb. However, we are authorized to have up to 10 members, and we are continuously recruiting. So anyone who has any interest in doing this, I'd be very glad to talk to you. Carol Ballard, our administrator, also would be happy to take a call or an email, and we'd like to try to get you interested. I'd like to recognize the service to the committee over the past year. Wally Greeno was the chair until December 31st, and then somehow she's convinced me to take over. CJ Stauffer was a member until March of 2021, and Dave Volk finished his two-year term in June and is devoting more time to the golf course now. We've had since the last AGM, Jessica Bassett was a temporary ASC administrator, and then Krasinda Plenkovich was hired and did a superb job until she found a job that she liked better and fit her life needs better. And Ken Johns has served as construction compliance consultant for a number of years and done an excellent job. He's really provided great service, great information, and even an education to the committee. As mentioned already, Carol Ballard has come on to replace Krasinda in the administrator position. Carol is experienced as an administrator for the ASC in another large homeowners association in the past. And John Gordon, the new construction compliance consultant, has similar experience in another organization in the recent past. So we were very lucky and fortunate to be able to recruit experienced replacements that will keep us running smoothly. The committee interprets and enforces the rules of the community, the CCNRs, the standards for residential construction, and the rules that affect those issues. And the purpose of the committee is stated in the CCNRs, as it says on the slide, and that is our focus, is to maintain a beautiful, natural, harmonious appearance of the community and follow the rules that have been set for accomplishing that. And here's a review of what we've done up to, this is the first 42 weeks of this year and the different types of actions we take. But the summary is we've had in those 42 weeks, 247 submissions to the committee that require committee consultation and action. 70% of them are approved without change. In any election, that would be considered a landslide in favor of approval. We do, however, receive submissions that require change and alteration, and occasionally simply can't be accommodated because they don't follow the rules, the CCNRs and the standards. But overall, the approval rate's quite high, and we try very hard. We meet twice a week, try very hard to be prompt in responding to those requests. So now I'll turn this over to Bill McNally, the chair of the Environmental Committee. Thank you, Steve. And how do I advance? Spacebar? Okay. Thank you. Okay, this is the Environmental Committee staff, myself, Stan Monks, and Jennifer Pombaum, who is in the front row here. And the Environmental Committee has been in existence for a number of years, but I took over the beginning of this year. And the first task was to create a charter, which did not exist up to that point. And we've been generating charters for all of the committees this year. And these are the tasks that we, the team and I came up with as the primary goals of the Environmental Committee. It's always been tasked with dealing with the undeveloped lots and making sure that they are keeping up with the standards that are in the CCNRs. And Jennifer has been our primary worker bee in that regard. And she also was the primary driver for guidelines, creating the guidelines for maintenance of undeveloped lots, which we revised this year. In addition, our other topics, we're now evaluating moving from gasoline-powered landscaping equipment to electric power. And that's my primary task that I've taken on. More to come on that. And we're also developing recommendations for environmentally friendly herbicides and insecticides. And Stan is working with the SRA board and the ASC to create a plan for a tree planting initiative by a memorial tree program. And all of these topics are going to appear in the SRA newsletter. We have a schedule set up, so you will be seeing more of all of these topics, and we will be looking for feedback from the community to guide us in the directions we might be headed in these topics. And as you saw from our staffing levels for this committee, we are definitely interested in additional volunteers. So if any of this appeals to you, we're happy to welcome you. Okay, I'm turning this over to Joe and for the Finance Committee report. So someone can take over running the, there we go.
Thank you, Bill. Hello, everyone, again. I will not take up as much as your time on this presentation. On the Finance Committee, I'm very happy to say that there are all four of us, April Hashimoto, Tom Lampe, and Karen Swanson, are finance people by trade. That's what we have done through our lives, involved in our businesses. And it makes it a lot easier to be able to talk numbers or strategies, savings, revenue possibilities with people who are familiar with financial statements, financial accounting standards, et cetera, et cetera. As my wife says, when I go to a finance committee meeting, it's like, okay, you guys go crunch your numbers and tell me the result when you're done. She seems to think that we love to crunch numbers when in fact, what we like to do is talk about strategies for the association that are going to be efficient and effective for the community as a whole. So April, Tom, and Karen, thank you very much for the time that you've put in. It's most appreciated. On next slide, please. Our significant achievements in 2021. We got off to a shaky start early in the year after the last AGM, but the committee reformed in March when I joined the board. And since then, we added a new member and I was added as the treasurer. So we looked at all the financial, or almost all the 2021 financial updates. And many of you may know, many of you may not know, that every month I do an update for 2021 with an outlook for what the rest of the year looks like. So it's the entire year picture. In the past, when I look at what was occurring, they would do year-to-date presentations, but there weren't any formal outlooks for what the entire year looked like. So when there were questions about it, there weren't, from my point of view, good answers about what the entire year looked like, because nobody was updating the financials through the end of the year. So the Finance Committee has looked at 2021. They assisted in helping to create and then review the operating budget before it went to the board for the final approval that went in the AGM package. We created and brought to the board two of the four resolutions for the AGM, which concerned debt and unbudgeted spending. I already went over the debt one briefly. The unbudgeted spending, that the results will be informed a little bit later on in this AGM, were if the board believes that they need to spend more money or different kinds of money during the year than were approved by the residents during this AGM, then if the amounts are significant, then the board has is mandated to inform the community that they are going to be spending certain amounts of money in advance of spending it. And if the amount is more significant and the amount happens to be $50,000, then any of those budgeted items that they want to spend, and I'm on the board, so that includes me, must need to go to the residents for a vote about those items. So that was an important thing that was brought forward by the Finance Committee in order to allow the residents to be more involved, because residents have clearly communicated over the last year that they do want to be more involved when things change substantially. And the last thing of significance that we've done in the last couple of months, we've had preliminary discussions on a revenue framework where we might be able to bring in more revenue into the association so that it's for the amount of work that's being done in certain areas that we might be able to charge a little bit more money. One example that was included in the 2022 budget was which I worked with Steve Haynes on as well, which was a greater fee for the Architectural Standards Committee for the beginning of new buildings, because we believe that it is not, or it shouldn't be a requirement for the community to chip in a whole bunch of money for the work that's done on new house starts by new builders. So we're going to work on that. We're going to propose it. By this time next year, for sure, we're going to come up with a set of recommendations for the next AGM. And so in a nutshell, that's what we've been working on this year. And the one thing I'll just reiterate is we are always focusing on spending the right amount of money on the right things for the entire community. And I look specifically at the operating fund and the reserve fund as being a combined budget. They're different. You have to account for them separately, but money being spent needs to be spent wisely. Effectively and efficiently is always a term that I like to use, and we will continue to do that so that you have confidence that we're going to be hopefully marching in the right direction for the SRA. Thank you very much. And with that, I'd like to introduce Jeff to talk about governance.
Okay, good morning, everyone. It's good to see everyone here. Thank you all for coming and for your interest in our community. My name is Jeff Ferry. I joined the board in March, and then in April, now I see Joe over here. I was appointed as the governance chair, and so I'm serving along with my colleagues here, Doug Woods, Steve Haynes, and Jane, who's dipping the toe in the Mediterranean, as we know. So in addition to some of these key highlights, I think one of the things that we are trying to do, as Doug mentioned earlier, is reinforce the separation between governance and management, something that will help with the efficiency and the function of our board and management structure. We've also formalized our charter, and that's important. Gives us an idea of what is our focus, our priorities, our objectives. And that'll be a continual process of updating it as we move forward. We're also trying to get our hands around the schedule of fines and enforcement. This is a work in progress, but we sort of did the initial review and we'll continue that work in 2022. Another thing we're trying to get our hands around is the NHOA, the neighborhood associations, some of which exist, some of which don't exist, some which work, some which don't really work, and sort of the separation of duties and responsibilities between the SRA, mother SRA, and the NHOA. So we've had a preliminary discussion in 2021, and there's a lot of work to do in 2022. I think that's probably one of our focus areas, if you will, for our work in the coming year. We've also been involved along with some of the other committees on the Carnoustie bioswale, which we've talked a lot about in the town halls, and the Carnoustie buffer. So these are a few of the key highlights from our work this year. Looking ahead to next year, we, as I mentioned, will continue to modify or revise as necessary the charters that we have. We look, as a governance committee, we look at across all of the committees. There is a sort of a template, but there are some differences from committees, committee to committee. One of the other areas we'll focus on is the potential review and revision of some of the CCNRs. I know that's a delicate topic, but it's important that we look and make the revisions where they're needed so that we can continue to have a very precise set of governing documents, rules, and regulations. And we'll bring those forward to the community for approval. As I mentioned earlier, we want to bring together the NHOAs and the ones that exist and the SRA officers to create some sort of a forum or discussion forum for sharing of information. And so we'll work on and doing that. There'll be opportunities as well for input from the community, how to organize that. And of course, we'll continue our work, which is ongoing, on the Carnoustie buffer and bioswale. So those are a few of the key priorities for the coming year. And of course, we'll keep you all informed through our work and the regular meetings that we have, as well as any other special meetings that we have during the year. And with that, I'd like to turn the floor over to John Palin, who is our maintenance chair. Thank you.
Thank you, Jeff. I'm John Palin. I joined the board in April to fill a vacancy. And since then, I have become the chairman of the maintenance committee. The official maintenance committee charter was originally approved in June of this year, and it was revised in July after we were unable to achieve a quorum and actually meet. And I want to especially acknowledge the volunteers and members of the board. I am the chair. Ed Castaneda is a former facilities director at Central Washington University. Jonathan Huggett is a professional engineer in Canada and the UK. And they both bring a lot of really important experience to the committee. Charlie Fordyce is a new member, and Bill McNally, the board member, is also was formerly the co-chair. And as always, we are looking for new members. We appreciate your volunteering if that is something you'd like to do. In 2021, we had a number of activities. I'll just touch on a few. Getting the street sweeper functional again was a giant undertaking. And we now have in-house staff that can not only operate and repair the equipment, but also do the preventive maintenance on it, which is so important to keeping it going. It's a, I have not been in the cockpit of this sweeper, but I'm told it looks like the cockpit of a 747. It's got two big diesel engines that make the thing run. It's a big deal. And we are really, really fortunate to have in-house staff at this point to be able to do that. And the regular sweeping operation is now back in operation the last Monday and Tuesday of every month, plus as needed following big storms. And I have been trying to make sure we get an advance notice put out to the residents a day or two ahead of time, so you know people are prepared. And hopefully they'll come forward as we proceed. Gates are a big thing. You know, we run in and out of those gates every day, and they are aging, and there has not really been an adequate maintenance program in place for the gates. We now are developing in-house capability. Bruce and company are now following a maintenance checklist. They'll go out and sweep the tracks and make sure they're clean on a weekly basis, do preventive maintenance on the bearings and the wheels and the chains. Which if you go and look at one, it's probably pretty rusty. Anyway, I feel good about that. And then we'll be trying to replace the oldest ones as budget permits in the coming year. Landscaping was another big activity. There was a significant cleanup and mulching of most of the gates and a significant effort to repair the sprinklers at Rex Park, which have been inoperable for a number of years. The committee's work going forward for the rest of the year will be primarily on delivering annual and the effectiveness of forward ongoing. We are shifting towards a little bit bigger emphasis on outsourcing. Particularly, we're going to try landscaping in 2022 and aligning the staff that we have with the tasks that that need to be done, that can be done with in-house staff. Priorities are entrance signs. There'll be some capital expenditure to replace the worst of those and upgrade them with more durable materials. Also, replacement of some gates and significant maintenance on the Drayton Hillside 2 bioswale, which is down at the kind of southeast end of the path around Drayton Harbor. If you go walking by there and you wonder what that thing is, well, that's the bioswale. Budget-wise next year, the operational budget is $411,000, which is a 11% increase over the current year. And reserve spending forecast to be $114,000. One of the most important things that we need to get done this year is to have a realistic inventory of the condition and cost estimates for maintaining our infrastructure, roads in particular. And that will feed the reserve study that will be done this year, which is a really important thing to get done right. So that'll be a big focus for us. And with that, I'll turn it back over to Jeff and the Safety and Security Committee.
Okay, it's me again. I am pinch hitting for Jane this morning, who, as we know, is dipping her toe in the Mediterranean. I want to first start with our committee members, Val Panu and Mike Fenston, Pat Kingshot, who is in the room, Richard Arnold, and Valerie Norris. Thank you all very much for all of the work you're doing. I've been a member of the committee since I moved to Semiahmoo. Then I was the chair for a short amount of time. And now it's in the hands, very capable hands of Jane Moore. So you can read there on the screen, but our primary focus on the committee is your safety, our safety and security. And one of the things we're working on now is a neighborhood block watch program. There are a couple communities areas in our community that have a functioning block watch program. We want to roll that out across our community. And so we are working with the Blaine PD, and they will actually be helping with the training of what we're calling block watch captains, who will sort of organize and coordinate the work of the block watch program in a specific area within a neighborhood. So I understand, you probably got the thing in the SRA news mailing a few weeks ago, talking about that. Hopefully you are already volunteering or expressed your interest to be a volunteer for the Block Watch program. The first training will be held, as it says here, on 17th of November at 2 p.m. In the SRA Center or via Zoom. And if you haven't already expressed your interest in doing that, you can contact Jane or Lori Thorne. And then the other thing is, see something, say something. We're all out in our community. And so if you see something that's happened, if you have had a security issue yourself, theft of something or whatever, contact the Blaine PD if you feel it rises to that level, 911, there to answer. That we keep of all of these different things that have happened in our community. It's important for our information, for monitoring to see if it's increasing, decreasing, different types of things are happening. There is also a tips type of thing that's been developed, how to increase your security. That you might want to check out, and it's at that address there. So safety and security is all of our responsibility. So I thank you for helping out with that to make our community more safe and secure. And next, I want to hand the floor to Patricia Oliveras, is the communications chair.
Good morning, still morning, I hope. I am Patricia Alvarez. I am the chair of the Communications Committee. I would like to first address and acknowledge the people who meet together. Oh, we meet every monthly, which is Sylvia Hayden. I know she's at Zoom, Guy Kelly, Jennifer Plumbon, she's right over here, Debbie Smith, Kathy, and Robin Trubin. Robin is just recently joined us, and she's a new resident. She would like to get very much involved. Not only these people make possible all communications from the board to you being sent, but also the staff in the office, Lori and obviously Justine. They all put together all of our thoughts and prepare all the stuff going on towards you. So I would like to acknowledge them as well. The
Communications Committee meets every month. We all put and gather all the information which is relevant, and we'll like to transmit it to you. All the communications, we like to keep it factual and very objective, but still remain personal as well, because we are residents and so are you. The plans for the future still are evolving. We are a committee that evolves all the time. Every time that we meet, we analyze all the analytics and to see how the communications are being received to you. We have the same e-news, we keep stats on that, and we see how much do you read on that, which topics are the most mostly read, not just to click on it, but really people that open the documents. So those are things that are going to change as much as how much you really perceive, how much you really get into that. If things that are not that important, that are not well read, well, we'll probably just put it on the back page. But it's all the communications are always going to be evolving. We like to be proactive based on what your interests are. We're also going to be doing a lot of improvements on the website, and there's going to be a video that is going to follow. We will try to keep the website as the main source of information that is going to be actual information, all the documents that are quite important, CCRs, documents, meetings, everything is going to be mostly on the website that is going to be accessed through you. So having said that, I am going to proceed to have a video that we presented to you. Okay, just bear with me. Sorry about this.
I just want to quit this PowerPoint because it's extending the screen.
Yeah. My apologies for that video that is not being there. But we'll try to keep it on the website, or if you would like to have access to that, I'll make sure that it is accessible to you. Now I would like to yield the floor to Helen, who's going to give us her update.
Thank you. I'm Helen Worley, and I'm chair of the Elections Committee.
Welcome to the 2021 annual Samiamo meeting. In this short presentation, we will talk about the website. Our existing website has gotten a little old and is not as usable as it should be, and so the Board of Directors has committed to replacing it with something more modern and with a full mapping capability. We are building a mapping system based on GIS and have begun building the new website. The new homepage looks like this. Over the next couple of months, the work will be complete and two members of SRA staff will be trained how to code in HTML and to maintain the website. The menu bar at the top gives access to all the public portions of the website. It also has a place for residents to log in to the residents-only areas. On the left side of the page is a sign-up area for first-time residents, and on the right side we see the area for returning residents to log in. The new mapping system is in the members-only area. The map allows for zooming in and moving so that specific areas can be seen, and with sufficient zoom, individual buildings can be seen. By clicking on a building, information about the building and the owner becomes visible. The website also has portraits and biographies of the very attractive members of the board. Please be nice to them at all times. There is a whole section on the committees that are part of the SRA management system. Here you see information on the Environmental Committee. The committee menu is a pull-down menu that provides quick access to all of the committees. There is also a page that provides an overview of them all. Returning to the home page, we plan to add links to materials that will be of interest to members and outside prospective buyers, such as the bylaws and CC&Rs. At the bottom of the home page, we see three image links to local amenities. The one on the left links to the golf course. The one in the middle links to the Semiahmoo Marina. And the one on the right links to the Semiahmoo Resort facilities. Bon appetit! This replacement website is a work in progress, and we plan to transition to it in the next month or two. Thank you for listening.
Well, thank you. I also would like to acknowledge Robert Elphick, who has put this presentation together. He's a webmaster, and he'll be continued improving the website. Thank you very much.
Yes.
Now,
without further ado.
Let's try this again. I'm Helen, and I'm chair of the Elections Committee, and I think that video was great, and I'm really looking forward to seeing the new updated website. It's going to be super. The members of the Elections Committee have had a hard-working year, and they've always been there. They've been to more meetings than they ever wanted to be at, and they've done them all diligently, and I want to thank them. Peggy Burton, who's sitting over there, and Rob Lee. Is Pam here? I can't see her. I don't think so, and I know Tippi Vaughn is not. But I really want to thank them, and all of you should, because they have done a wonderful job. We are a formal chartered committee established in the bylaws, and we're responsible for initiating and conducting all association elections, board, budget, CC&R amendments, et cetera. Having that charter has been a real asset. There's been an elections committee forever, and I have been on it, and it's evolved over the years, but now there is a charter with specifics, and that has been really, really good. So in this year, we also developed an elections manual. So all the procedures for elections are now specified, detailed, with timelines, et cetera, so that it can be passed on to others, and of course it can be revised. We conducted several special elections this year. You've heard a couple of board members talk about that they were elected at various meetings. And of course, we conducted the election of the special general meeting. A lot of work. And we initiated and supervised the elections for this meeting, for the board coming in, the ratification of the budget and the CCNR amendments. But I want to make a comment about how we vote. Debbie spoke to this, but I'm going to elaborate a bit more. For the last few years, the SRA has moved to online voting. I think it was David Stewart who really pushed for that. And we use Election Runner, and the whole system works really, really well. And it saves a ton of money. But this year, we still had to print and mail 220 AGM packets. Each one of them cost $5. $5 times 220 is roughly $1,100. Okay, so you send them all out. Here's the thing that really irks. Of the 220 that were mailed, only 33 were returned. Now, I think I'm speaking to the choir, but with that very low rate of return, the effective cost of those 33 is $33. So if anybody watching or here is still receiving a mailed packet, I implore you, and our treasurer would endorse this, to contact the office, contact Lori, and sign the permission for the SRA to deal with you electronically. That's my little speech. Now, we move on to the election results. The first budgets. Under Washington state law, unless 50% plus one of all eligible voting units vote to defeat the budget, it is ratified. Only 5% of the membership voted to reject the budget, so the 2022 budget was ratified. Nice and simple. Now we read to the election of the board of directors. And we have five who were elected. Jeff, sitting right here. Mike Harkleroad, could you stand, Mike? And his nice bright yellow is joining the board. John Palin, whom you've been listening to. Joe Southey, who you've been listening to but can't see. Thank you, Joe. And the other new member is Mohammed Tazim. Mohammed, please stand. And they will be joining or rejoining Steve Geisels, who is right here, Steve Haynes next to him, the tipping her toe in the Mediterranean, Jane Moore, and my neighbor, Doug Woods. And as you know, we are awaiting the nomination from the resort to fill the position which Nicole Newton used to have. Now, on the other election results, the board resolution number 2, and this was regarding the unbudgeted expenditures, and I think Joe spoke quite eloquently about it, that passed. The vote to approve was 95%. You got to have 66 and two-thirds to get it passed. That passed. The next board resolution regarding the independence of elections, That one was approved by 95%. This was concerning the membership on the committee. Then the next one concerned the board's action in creating a position which would be ex officio or non-voting, that not be allowed. And the vote to approve that amendment was 95%. There was a member resolution regarding the assumption of debt or liabilities, and that was passed by 87%. And now for some more numbers. Joe, it's over to you.
Sorry, I was muted and I couldn't unmute myself. So this is just a very brief announcement. Thank you very much, Helen, that for the coming year, so for this prior year for 2020, we had an audit done by Joseph Vandel CPA firm, and we asked them if they were to do an audit or a review of our financial statements for 2021, so sometime next year, approximately how much would the cost be? They said the cost would be approximately the same, whether it was going to be an audit or a review from their procedures. So we decided that it would be prudent if the costs were approximately the same, that we would do an audit again. So just to let you know, the requirement, I believe, is that we need to have an audit every 3 years, but we have the ability to do an audit every year if we choose to do so. Since the costs were about the same, we decided let's have another audit, because that gives the residents more comfort that the results or the updates that we're providing to residents on an ongoing basis are accurate. So just wanted to let you all know that we are going to have an audit performed for the 21 result or 21 financials. And instead of doing it, the actual activity normally happens in the summertime, which is about 6-7 months after the end of the year. We asked them if they would be available to do the audit earlier in the year to the tune of January or February starting, and then finishing maybe in February or March, so that we get the results a lot quicker, and that would be before their tax season. And they indicated on a preliminary basis that that should work. So we should have the results of an audit a long time earlier so that we're not crunched up against the AGM. When in this case, when we had to get the AGM package, we got the results of the audit a couple of days earlier, literally a couple of days earlier. And we didn't have time to go through the financials to see what the issues were, if there were any. But thanks very much. And I'd like to pass this on to Debbie to recognize volunteers from the past.
Thank you, Joe. When my son was in the fourth grade, he was asked to write something about his mom. And he wrote, she likes pleases and thank you, kids and cats and dogs. So I've always been a big believer of saying thank you. And I think that this is always a wonderful opportunity to thank everyone that's given so much of their time and express our appreciation. So I'll begin with the board of directors, Alec Berkman, Carol Gosch, Julia Green, Paul Greenow, Kurt Hagman, Michael Hayden, Nicole Newton, Jennifer Plombaum, and Dave Ulis. Next, the Architectural Standards Committee, Wally Greenow, Ty Jackson, CJ Stauffer, David Vogt. Communications, Neil Ingledow, Trevor Hoskins, Bill McNally, Jennifer Plombaum, CJ Stauffer, Carmen Thiebel, and Helen Worley. Elections, Georgia Donovan and Brian Johnson. Environmental, Julia Bolts, Mary Margaret Liu, David Stewart, Sarah Ulis. Maintenance, Sue Berkman, Colin Dial, Ian Duckworth, John Gaff, Tom Hanrahan, Stan Magrita, and Jennifer Plombaum.
That will conclude the appreciation for everyone that has given their time. And I think if we could give everyone a round of applause. Okay, next we're going to move to question and answer. And just very quickly on the protocol, we will alternate between audience members and Zoom attendees. If you are attending via Zoom, please sign up in the chat option. Lori will announce members in order of request. The public chat is for sign up only. There will be no discussion taking place on the public chat. Members will be limited to 3 minutes for Q&A. Members will not be interrupted by the board or members who either agree or disagree with what they are saying. A speaker seeking a longer time can ask someone else who has signed up to speak to yield their time so the speaker can continue. However, at no time will any member be allowed to use more than 6 minutes to speak. A timer will be used to alert speakers when 30 seconds is remaining by ringing the bell. At the conclusion of the presentation, if the member is speaking from a written statement, they may submit their written statement to the secretary via Lori's email to assist with its inclusion in the minutes. After the member speaks, the board may answer or ask clarifying questions. The presiding officer will then thank the member for their presentation and will move to the next speaker. Personal attacks on board members or fellow association members are strongly discouraged, and profanity will not be tolerated under any circumstances. So with that, I will turn this over to Doug.
Before we open up for questions, there's one very, very important thing that we need to do right now. And that is the board, our committee members, would like to take a moment to shine a very bright light where it's well-deserved. Thank you, Debbie, for 34 years of loyal, dependable service to this community. You were here when the second home was built. And we now have almost 900 homes. You've served every president, every board of directors, and have coordinated and managed every AGM since Semiamo started. Your signature, your blood, sweat, and tears will forever be a part of the Semiamo history. Thank you. Come over, Debbie, and just say a minute. Share your tears.
I didn't know he was going to do that. So I think I'm going to just keep it real simple and say it's been an honor. And this community will always hold a very special part in my heart. And I wish the board, the community members, and the staff all the best. I will remain in Whatcom County, and you just never know when I might show up. So thank you, everyone.
In the question and answer session, I believe we're going to alternate a person here and then a person online. Is that correct? Okay, so first person, Lori is going to be our moderator, so she'll...
Barbara Palin will be first.
Thank you, Lori. My name's Barbara Palin. I live in the Semiamu Shores condominium community, one of the newest ones in the SRA. I first want to really thank every board member for such thorough and engaging presentations. It was really a pleasure to listen to all of it. My question is probably for Jane Moore, so maybe Jeff, since you filled in for her, about the safety. I'd like to propose or ask that we look at, as a community, what to do in the event of an emergency, be it a tsunami, an earthquake, especially those of us that live on this end of the spit and potentially the road may not be passable. I know a few of us individuals are making some plans to stock water, et cetera, and have a meeting place in the event that we wouldn't be able to drive off the spit. But it might be wise for the community to have some sort of a plan of action. This came to light with the latest duck and hold drill we had just a week or so ago. Thank you.
Barbara, that's a great suggestion. Part of the charter for the Safety and Security Committee is emergency preparedness. And so I think that falls under that category, so that we know what to do in the event that there is such a situation. So I don't really have much to say other than it's a very good suggestion, something that we will definitely take up. And of course, if you're interested in participating in that discussion, we would welcome that very much.
Thank you, and I'll be happy to participate when that takes place.
Barbara, someone from the room? Want to stand up by the microphone?
Yeah, my name is John Beagle, and I live in Carnoustie.
I hate to bring this up in such an atmosphere of good feeling, but if you look at the last amendment, it's a Trojan horse. It is not what it says it is. The appearance is that the SRA wants to walk away from the maintenance of some single family community, common area maintenances areas. For example, the bioswale in Carnoustie. The problem seems to have resulted from when the original CCNRs were approved, when our neighborhood was approved, that there was inconsistencies as far as who maintained what. Well, if the SRA doesn't treat everybody equally, it's violating the principle of, equal treatment of owners. The objective seems to be an extension of the program from last year, where the SRA was going to cause everybody to form an NHOA. These are not needed. If the SRA performs stormwater maintenance in St. Andrews Green or somewhere else, they're responsible for doing it in all the other neighborhoods. In looking at how this amendment got here, you might have to question how it actually did. The board turned it down 5-2, yet miraculously it appeared as a member's amendment. If you look at the CCNRs and the bylaws, there is no member's amendment. A member can request an amendment be proposed, but the board and the board alone has authority to put it on the agenda. I'm done. Anybody want to ask me any questions?
Thank you, John. I think as the Finance Committee reviewed that, and that the board reviewed that, that particular resolution, I think the context you see there is not accurate. The resolution does not change any of the maintenance requirements currently in place. And the maintenance requirements are depicted in the plat and in CC&Rs in each of those homeowners associations. Currently, SRA, it's our understanding that we primarily do all of the maintenance that is required in the plats and in our CC&Rs that call for the SRA to do. I know that in the Carnoustie plat, there is a provision that requires the Carnoustie homeowners to maintain their bioswale. I believe, in talking with Jason Ragsdale, that those CC&Rs were amended that moved that responsibility from the single family residences down to the multifamily residences.
Jason filed an amendment where he fraudulently misrepresented that he was the declarant.
And
he could not have been the declarant. He didn't exist when the party that transferred title to Carnoustie to the lender. It was 3 years after that before Jason even started his company. Jason has a problem with that.
Well, and therefore the reason why Carnoustie needs to form their HOA. But I believe, John, this is a great initiative for you to bring to the board. And I don't think that we should belabor that topic any further in this forum until it has been fully reviewed and worked on at the board level so that it can come back to the president.
You have no legal standing to force us to create an HOA. Only the members can or a declarant can. There's no declarant. And last year you went through a jihad using false and misleading information, trying to bully us into doing it. It didn't work. And this isn't going to work either. I'm done.
Okay. We'll take the next question.
Christopher Hutton.
Hello. I'm Christopher Hutton. I live in Carnoustie as well. My question is regarding the use of funds. So maybe this one goes to Joe. I don't know who can answer this question, but first I'd like to say thank you to everybody for all their volunteer work and the presentation today. It's been very informative and you've answered a lot of questions that I was going to ask. But one in particularly that bothers me that I'd like to address is the fact that we have the intent of the board was to not to increase the dues for everyone this year, but it seems to me that that could have been accomplished or at least could have been mitigated through the use of some of the cash we have on hand. With respects to all of that, my question is, why are we not going to use any of the operating or restricted reserve funds to offset any of the dues increase, given the fact that we have $1 million in the bank and that money is earning interest?
Joe, would you like to respond to that?
Sure. So Chris, thank you for the question. I don't have an answer to that question other than what I said in my presentation, which is, having $1 million in cash at this moment in time, that's not where we're projected to end the year because we've still got 2 months or 3.5 months from when this presentation was created to end the year. It's estimated that we're going to end the year with closer to 900,000 or maybe 850 or something like that. That said, what your basic number one, I think you made a comment that the board, or maybe it was individual people, I'm not really sure where you got the information, said that we weren't going to have a dues increase this year. I've been on the board for 7 months and I've never said anything about what was going to happen in the next 7 months or in the next few months or next year about dues. And I'm a resident like you are. I don't like dues to be increased unless it's necessary. That said, the fact that we've got just under $1 million by the end of the year in our bank accounts does not mean that we can go out and spend a bunch of it in order to do our operations or do maintenance on infrastructure items, call it the reserve fund. If we're going to draw down the reserve fund and then we're going to be left with special assessments sometime down the road related to roads, paths, SRA maintained bioswales and signs and gates, then I don't think the community is going to be thinking that special assessments are a good idea. But the reality, so one of the realities from my perspective is the when the reserve study was done a year ago, there were some inputs into that reserve study that didn't make an awful lot of sense from the actual cost to repair some of the things in our community. The most significant was roads. So it is currently estimated that if we were to resurface all our roads, which we're not going to anytime in the near future, but it's a reality at some point in time. If roads are 20, 30 years old, maybe as we approach 50 years old, they'll need to be replaced. I'm told that the cost of resurfacing a road is somewhere in the amount of $750,000 to $1.25 million per mile. We are so woefully short in our reserve fund to build up money for things like that, that we can't afford to have the reserve fund go down on an ongoing basis, like was being proposed a year ago at the AGM. So we need to at least fund a reasonable amount of money to cover off expenditures in this year, in my opinion, because having a balanced budget is generally a good thing to do. That's my answer. I don't know if somebody else has anything to add.
Thanks, Joe. I'm going to just add that I think one of the things that we had hoped to accomplish this year and will definitely accomplish next year is a long-term budgeting model that allows us to project all of these things in our reserve study in advance so that as we look at our budgets and as we look at what's upcoming, we'll know how to better manage those increases or if you want, the assessments in the future with a real solid model that allows us to do forward projections and bring those back to constant values. Next question from this room, Al.
My name is Ted Metz, and I live in Stonehaven. Just something on safety, just so I've mentioned this many times in the past. There is an organization that's under the auspices of the Whatcom County Sheriff's Department called CERT, Community Emergency Response Teams. There's an existing one here in Birch Bay, Linden, and Blaine, and we would love to have people join that. So if you go onto the web, look up the Sheriff's Department, look for CERT, you can certainly make yourself available. We've done all kinds of exercises in the airport, drop and cover, rescue missions, all types of things. So we're actively looking for members. So if you want to join CERT or be part of it and include Semiamu, be great. Thank you.
Thanks, Ted.
Next on the list is Kurt Hagman. It may take a moment for him to get unmuted.
Yeah, I think I'm unmuted now. I have a couple of questions, but I'm going to change the order because we were just talking about reserve study. And a reserve study was not included in the voter packet for 2021, which is supposed to be there. And then further, I'm concerned that the board, without professional input, decided that no road maintenance was required no major road maintenance was required in 2021. And so I guess my question is, are we good? You know, there's all kinds of opinion about how much money should be held in the reserve account. But in my opinion, the only way to determine that is to hire a professional and get the professional opinion about what our future infrastructure needs are. And so the question to the board is, are we going to hire a professional reserve study firm to do an assessment, a reserve study in 2022?
I'll respond to that. The decision that we all discussed and agreed to was that early in the year, this coming year, we would bring our reserve study folks on board and actually do a deep dive on that reserve study so that we could actually bring valuable information and valuable data to that reserve study, so that it could be part of developing that long-term budgeting model. And so we deferred doing it late in the summer. We had hoped that we would have it done before we started our budgeting cycle this year. There was so much that was going on that it was one of those things that got put off. And then we decided that it's such a big priority and it's required by state law. We will do it early in the year and we'll do it thoroughly and we'll create a model that we can all have confidence in. And if anybody wants on the board wants to build on that. Next question. Well, you're still on, Kurt, sorry.
Kurt, did you want to ask your other question?
Yes, this one's to Joe Southey. The financial audit report is usually included in the voter packet. It was not included this year, but I noticed you did cover it briefly in your remarks. And you indicated we have a clean bill of health. But if you look at the 2020 financial statement that was previously posted on the website, there is some minor discrepancies between that statement and what the auditor came up with. I'd hope that you could post a reconciliation between the statement that we had posted up there and what the auditor came up with and explain the small differences. I think it's within a couple of $1,000s, but still it's it should be understandable.
Kurt, I'm not actually aware of those discrepancies, but to your point, I will follow up with the auditor after this meeting. I was going to be following up sometime in early November to chat about what they're going to be doing for the audit for this coming year. But I'll be honest, they never told me or Debbie when they delivered their audit report right at the last minute before the AGM materials had to be presented that there were differences. So I never went back to try and reconcile. So I apologize, I don't have an answer for that at this moment.
Thank you.
Next question from the audience here.
Hi, Jennifer Plombon, 5416 Goldfinch Way in Drayton Hillside. Just a quick question for, I think, John Palin. Do you have plans to hire any more full-time or part-time staff for the maintenance staff?
Thank you, Jennifer. The staffing plan was laid out in the town halls. And basically, there are no plans in the coming fiscal year to replace the two vacant maintenance positions as they exist right now. So that would leave the leader of the group along with one full-time staff, plus the part-time staff of Leroy, the sweeper expert, as well as potentially some seasonal landscape support staff, low, relatively low level. So that's the plan as it exists and as was reflected in the budget. Does that answer your question?
It does, thank you. Kurt Hagman.
Yeah, thank you. Hello again. This is a question kind of to the board as a whole. I heard no discussion today about the Drayton Harbor easement walking path. The last time I was down to the spit there, it appeared that that walking trail is closed along Drayton Harbor because of some landslide issues that have occurred. I think people can walk it on their own at their own risk, but what is the status of the Drayton Harbor easement walking path?
I'll respond to that.
And I guess the follow-up is, why is there no budget to address it if there's some issue there?
Does anybody on the board want to address that?
Well, I can make just a comment.
Go ahead, Jeff.
Well, oops. These masks, Elizabeth, glasses.
So I'm a user of that path myself. And yes, there have been a lot of slides. And I'm a member of the Safety and Security Committee, but as chair, I was always thinking, you know, what is the liability? Where is the liability lie if I'm walking there and a tree falls down or the walkway, you know, the asphalt sloughs away and I go down into Drayton Harbor, injure myself. So I guess it came about the same time that we had the situation in Florida with the condo. And so what we decided to do in safety and security is sort of do an audit of all of these different assets that we have in our community and discuss that with the insurance company and so on, just to see, to get clarity on sort of what the liability issues are, and you know, from us, and also from a safety and security standpoint. And so that work is being done now, and we're trying to coordinate that with the person who's doing the mapping exercise, which we hope will be finalized soon. And then I guess based on the outcome of that work, then, you know, if there are certain action items that need to take place, then we'll have a discussion around cost. But I'm not sure we're there quite yet, but it is an issue that's on the radar screen, Kurt. And so, you know, stay tuned as we work on that some more. That's what I can say.
Thank you, Jeff.
John, in the maintenance committee, thinking about next year, was there any consideration applied for that item?
No, there was not any particular focus on that path. As I understand it, there are some inconsistencies around who is actually responsible for that path. For example, the Erie Homeowners Association is responsible for that segment. I think the real issue is the slides that come down the hill. Is it the responsibility of the easement owner, basically SRA, to repair that slide, or is it the property owner whose hill it was that came down in the first place? So, I don't know, but it would be a really, really significant undertaking to try and fix that path. The city of Blaine abandoned it because it was impossible to maintain. So there have been, since my involvement or presence here, there has always been a sign saying, use it at your own risk. I walk it almost every day,
you know, there's trees that are coming down. There's a tree, a big tree that came down last week across the bioswale. You know, so it is definitely a use it at your own risk. And I don't recommend people being out there when the wind is blowing hard or after extensive rains. You know, that's when things are likely to happen. Long-term, it definitely needs to be addressed, but it's really unclear how to address it. It would be a giant expense.
Let me just ask Alec real quickly. Was there some research that was done last year on the legality of liability?
Yeah, just one comment. I think the our insurance premium that we pay, I believe the Drayton Harbor easement is included in the assets that they are covering. Now, whether they know the full extent of their liability there is not clear to me, but it's certainly worth identifying whether, in fact, the Drayton Harbor easement is covered under our existing insurance policy.
So, Alec, was there some work done on that in the last 2 years?
Yes, there was considerable work done on assessing whose liability is actually there at the bottom of the hill, because the hill didn't come down. The toe came out. The hill didn't slide down. The bottom came out, and it went across the easement. And by this point in time, I would suggest we should know whose liability it is. How you fix it, that's an entirely different question. But the SRA should understand what its liabilities are if somebody walks down there, quote, at their own risk, end quote. I don't believe there is such a thing. Somebody has that liability.
But that was not previously established?
I took a bad off ramp, so I don't know.
Thanks, Kurt. Was that the last of your question there on that?
Yeah, that's it for that. I have one final question, but I'll wait for someone else.
Yeah. A question from the room?
Sorry.
Go ahead.
Up and go for it. As I walk around our beautiful—
Identify yourself.
Yeah, I'm Charles Fordyce. I'm relatively new here, been here since April. I live in St. Andrews, and I walk through the entirety of our community, you know, almost every day, and I love it. But I noticed that along the Drayton Harbor side of the community, looking north, northeast towards the harbor, it's getting harder and harder to see the harbor, actually, because of tree growth. So I'm curious to know what the SRA does about that. I can see that in maybe another 10 years, it's going to be almost impossible to see the harbor from St. Andrews and from other parts that are up the hill, maybe Carnoustie in that area. Thank you.
Anybody want to take that on, Steve?
Yes, Steve Haynes, the very fortunate ASC chair. Trees are a major issue. A good portion of what the ASC deals with are requests to preserve trees or to get rid of trees or to trim them and make them look prettier and so on. So there are some governing principles that we are obliged to follow when we're dealing with. And one of them is the statement in the original Semiahmoo Resort master plan, which the city has adopted as part of the code for governing how we do this, which states, particularly for the what's called the uplands, which is all of St. Andrews Green and Carnoustie, and everything that's not down here on the state, basically, or not on the coast. is that the intent is for the all of these neighborhoods to be a community nestled in a forest. And in addition, the CCNRs tell the ASC that significant trees due to their large size cannot be replaced. This is quoting the CCNRs. Therefore, the retention will be considered during the design process of new homes. And secondly, there's a view control policy in place. So the need, the importance of view has been taken into account in the CCNRs. Specific lots are designated in specific neighborhoods that limit the height of trees and put a responsibility on the homeowner in those view control lots to appropriately trim and prune the trees that are not grandfathered in and so on. So that to a certain height. And those are the rules under which we can govern and manage the trees. There is not, other than the view control policy, there's not a guarantee of a view. Trees are part of the view. They're part of the natural setting in which we live, and we are obligated under the CCNRs to preserve as many of them as possible.
Quick, where is that? Where can I read more about that? Those rules?
On the website, go under ASC documents. The view control policy should be there. It's also incorporated in the standards for residential construction.
Thank you.
David Getsky.
Hi, good afternoon, everybody. Can you hear me okay?
Sure can.
Thank you for your time today. I wanted to follow up on an email that I sent on Tuesday, January 19th, 2021. To Alec Berkman and the SRA board. I had received a response from Alec with regard to the assets that we have under care invested in CDs. I noticed at that time that the budget was going to be going from 100% funded to only 85% funded in 2021. And my recommendation to the board was to consider alternative investment choices to earning 0.05% at the bank on $1 million. I suggested that the board review and consider other investments that provide modest inflation beating return, or at least inflation keeping pace return, which would meet the metrics that are defined by the investment policy statement. Metrics such as credit quality, liquidity management, portfolio duration, and active management. 25 years ago, we were all getting 5% on our money market funds, and today we get 0.05. And each day that passes means lost opportunity, lost investment return on relatively safe and well-managed investment portfolios. Alec responded with a letter saying that the investment policy statement was approved on April 29th, 2017, and from its inception, the SRA has a policy that all investments must be insured by FDIC. I think we can all agree that interest rates have been lower for longer for some time, and we should consider prudent investment management and prudent alternatives. So I was wondering if the SRA board has made any improvements to updating or considering updating the investment policy statement and looking at alternatives so that we can not lose pace to inflation and not lose money safely in FDIC insured accounts.
Joe, I'll let you respond to that as chairman of the finance committee.
So thank you very much for your question, David. And it's something that When I was joining the board a few months ago, I was looking at considering, are there alternative ways to figure this out where we would effectively get a better return? One of the thoughts that I had, and it's not something that we've chosen to move forward with at all at this moment, is instead of having a mortgage where we would pay, coincidentally or not, 5%, could we self-fund that mortgage with the funds that we have? So currently our mortgage is somewhere around $700,000, just under $700,000. And we've got just over $1 million in cash. So is it possible that we could do something like that? I've talked about that very briefly, top level, high level, without any consideration about doing something like that. But that is one way we can actually save 5%. We could say instead of saving 5%, we're actually making 5% on the amount of money that we pay off or pay down the mortgage. Is that a good way to utilize our money in case we might need money for like liquid money in order to take care of something that might come down the pipe? I don't really think so, but I also would like to earn a heck of a lot more money than the 0.1 or 0.25 that we're currently earning at CIT Bank. Coincidentally, that amount of money is more than you can get at most money market funds around the nation. I don't have an answer for you yet. I wish I did have an answer, but I think if we were to do something like that, we would have to significantly alter the investment policy. And I'm not exactly sure, I'm relatively new to the board, what the means would be to change it, whether we would have to go to another AGM similar like this or another all residents meeting where residents vote on in order for them to agree that that's a good thing to do. Right now we're taking a conservative route because we don't want to lose any of our money. I'm fully aware that it's not meeting our needs as inflation is a lot higher than anything we can earn, which means effectively we're losing purchasing power. But it's something, thanks for bringing it up. And I think that's something we should look at, although I don't know that we'll be able to come to a conclusion in the near future.
Thank you, Joe. From the floor.
Good morning, Ted Mishaikoff from the Sea Smoke Development. Did I cut you off?
No.
Sorry, okay. This will be quick. For the ASC, I wasn't aware that the primary topic of discussion is to cut or not to cut, which I find very interesting. And I thought the explanation and the foundation of these decisions is, of course, pretty well known. But I didn't hear in your comment an aspect of safety and security. And how does that issue play into the decision-making of the ASC as it relates to cutting or not cutting? That's hopefully a quick question. The bigger question is, if it's such a large question facing your committee, is the committee looking at fundamentally addressing that sort of in a holistic manner going forward? Thank you.
I assume, Ted, you're talking about trees?
I am.
Yeah, okay.
Oh, I couldn't figure that out. So the tree policy says a dead, diseased, or dangerous tree can be removed with ASC approval. So what we ask for is, and there's a form online, that those three things are on there, check the box. It's a dead tree, we want to take it out. We also have an emergency dangerous tree removal policy that says if it's immediately dangerous to person or property, you can take it down and then submit the form for retroactive approval. And that's just so that people don't play games with it. I mean, so tree is leaning and the form actively approve it, and then there's no issue. However, anything that isn't dead, diseased, or dangerous, we're pretty protective of, for the reasons
for the reasons I said. And if those requests come in as not as an urgent issue, we visit sites every other week. And the committee will go out to the site and look at the tree or trees in question. And if we agree, it gets approved. We have had occasions where perfectly healthy trees that are not dead, diseased, or dangerous have been requested for removal. And based on the rules that we're supposed to follow, it's very hard to approve that. So we're trying to follow the rules. And the only way we can make consistent, fair, and equitable decisions that apply to everybody as equally as we can is to follow the rules. So that's what we're trying very hard to do.
Next on my.
Kurt Hagman has additional questions.
Yeah, this is a comment on the investment policy. As you know, I was the treasurer up until the end of March of this year. And before I left the board, at the last board meeting in March, the board approved a new investment policy, which includes the ability to buy US government treasury bills and top rated, i.e. AAA corporate notes. So it has been widened slightly, but not including those more exotic things that Joe mentioned. I just thought I'd set the record straight on that point.
Thank you, Kurt.
Next question from the floor.
Good afternoon, Lawrence Ellis. Just moved into the Marin. And my question is the fees for the association, are they equitable between homeowners and the condo owners? I just don't see the equitable there. We don't have a gate. The sign is very, the sign is existence, but I don't think it's working. I don't know if the lights are working there or not. So my question is, are the fees between the condo owners and homeowners equitable?
I don't know that that's a treasurer's response. It's whether it's a Debbie Smith response or whether that's almost anybody's response here from a standpoint that we all of the assessments are outlined in the CCNRs and the way those are laid out. There's always been a question about equity as it relates to some of the folks in the newer condominium developments where there is no trees, there are no roads, and the other neighborhoods. And is that a discussion that could be broached by the overall association? Absolutely, it can be. But right now, it kind of is what it is, and you have to make your own assessment of whether or not there is equity and value in those dues for you. And every one of them is going to be different. Every association, every homeowner, those are all going to be different. So I don't know if we can answer that any better. Does anybody want to take a shot at expanding on that?
Because we have no gate, I haven't seen a sweeper there. I've been here for a few months and I'm actually just not seeing much.
The assessments are somewhat lower for the condos. Actually, what you're making is a very strong argument in favor of the neighborhood association setting, which would allow the SRA assessments to cover things that broadly cover the entire community and allow the neighborhood association groups to tailor their assessments for the things that are specific to them.
so that there is more equity and the differences are more directly related to individual neighborhood circumstances. And that's true for many of these existing condos. And it would apply more generally to the neighborhoods that have differential needs and requirements.
That's a hard one to discuss in a forum like this, but at some point, if a working task force be put together to talk about it, I think that that's something that would be productive.
Right, that'd be great. Thank you.
Next online question.
If you would allow it, Kurt Hagman has an additional question.
All right, this is really my last question. I really didn't identify myself initially. I am a homeowner in St. Andrews Green 2 and live on Goshawk and was a former board member up until the end of March. My final question has to do with the voter packet. It did not identify the projected balances in either the operating fund or the restricted reserve fund. And mainly because the only place you can really see those is in the balance sheet or the cash flow statement. I hope that information could be provided on the website in the future.
So Kurt, to that question, one of the things I was trying to do, you were asked about a different reconciliation a little bit earlier. I was trying to reconcile the reserve balance that the auditors had on their balance sheet compared to what you as the former treasurer and the board had in the financial statements for the last AGM. And I am, it's beside myself to try and figure out the difference between the balance for the operating fund on an ongoing basis as well as the reserve fund. Because if you look at the balance sheet that was posted to the PowerPoint presentation and in the AGM, and it's, or in the AGM package, sorry, it says that there's $883,000 sitting in assets in the reserve fund at the end of the year, which when you compare to the numbers that you and Jennifer and people had presented before, is nowhere near close. Like to the tune of out, it's a, what they did, and I haven't had a chance to talk to them about why there's this discrepancy, is they just said basically all the extra funds sit in the reserve fund, where what you had as a running total, it was about roughly a 50-50 split. So given that we had virtually no time to present or to prepare documentation and ask the auditors questions from the time they gave us the audit report to the time that the AGM package had to be completed, I was actually hoping to do it on the presentation, but I realized I don't have enough information to be able to figure this out. However, you bring up a good point, and I want to understand that. And as we are engaging them again, that'll be a question to understand the remaining balance in the, or call it the reserve fund balance and the operating fund balance, which were somewhere in the neighborhood of $400,000 a pop, maybe 450, whatever it is. I don't have a reconciliation. I don't know how to get one at this moment in time very quickly. There will be one within the next couple of months.
Thanks, Joe. Thank you, Kurt. I'm going to take one last call. We're at the end of our time allotment. So
Wilson, I mean, question. Next year's budget and all of the reserve budget proposals and plans, and there is nothing in that budget that affects Pacific Point. Not a penny will be spent on Pacific Point or anything in our neighborhood, as far as I can tell. If I'm wrong, please let me know. But somehow in the assessment of of, you know, what we have to pay, we need to calculate what we're getting back out of it. Because from my perspective, I get very little, if anything, out. I mean, we're going to be funding roads and gates that I'll never drive on, I'll never pass through. And I'm trying to understand why we're assessed at the same level as a homeowner who, you know, benefits from all of the services. And I think there does need to be some way that we can change the assessment so that that's reflected in some way. Just a comment, thank you.
Thanks, Steve. So with that, I wanna thank everybody for being here, for your support, advice, patience through the year. And thank you for your intelligent and thoughtful questions. Appreciate everything you've done, and I appreciate everything our board, our committee, our staff has done this year. And with that, we stand adjourned.